But the point here is that people have been misled because there's so many different versions of what's going on out there. So many versions of the Bible. I didn't know that there's this NIV and there's the American Bible and there's this Bible and that. I mean, how many Bibles are there now? 60. How many?
At least
60. 60?
Yeah,
60 Bibles. 60 Bibles. I thought in the back of it, it says you won't change one jot or one tittle. You change one word and I'll write you out of the book of life. So if there's all these different versions of Bible, how do you know which one is the right one? Well, what you do is you go and you start searching and you look through the different translations. Joyce and I have a whole bunch of Bibles at home, just cross-referencing. And there is one Bible that is closer to the original translations than any of the others. And then you have to ask, why are all these others around here? Well, it's not up to me to answer that, but that's what our next guest is going to talk about. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Carl Sanders.
Thank you, brother. You did a good job. There we go. I like this. There's no clock up here to tell me when to start and stop. I'm Carl Sanders with Trumpet Ministries. I don't play a trumpet, but I sound a warning. For 32 years, I worked for the government. I worked for the CIA, the FBI, and the Customs. That isn't what I'm going to be talking about here today, but I have just been blessed by the previous guests, by the speakers, what Charlotte had to say about the attack on Christianity. The attack on Christianity came because of the attack on this book. And I worked in the Phoenix Project. I was exposed to Agent Orange and Agent White in Indochina before it was Vietnam. And an area that we weren't supposed to be into. But that's not what I'm here to talk about today. I'm here to talk about why I carry a King James Bible. And a lot of this is going to be on overheads. I'm going to show you some of the things that are going on. But I'm excited about what God has done in my life. I'm not all here tonight. You can say you're being spoken to by somebody that's not all here. I had colon cancer in 1990, been running from God. And I have a colostomy, I have a kidney missing, I have a part of my pancreas, part of my liver. I'm not all here, folks. But I'm going to tell you something. I love the Lord Jesus Christ, and He has kept me going. And so what I'm here to do today is thank you. Thank you. He is the healer, not only the healer, He is my healing, and I appreciate it. I lost my wife about 2.5 years ago. We'd been married 47 years. She was a constant companion to me. She was the singer. You won't hear me sing, but she sang. And she's waiting on the other side of Jordan for me. And I'm going to get there. So don't get in my way or I'll run over you. But I believe this old Bible. And I want to tell you where the problem started was very early. And just read you a little bit about where the problem started. In Genesis chapter 3, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall you touch it, lest ye die. And Satan came right back in the next verse and said, and the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die. One word was changed. One word changed, and that's where it began. So we're in a situation for now, we have a lot of people testing NIV positive. So I'm going to talk about the Bibles. It's amazing what has been done. Gail Repplinger is a good friend of mine. She stood with me in times in years past. But I have been very critical of what has happened with the new versions of the Bible. I call them perversions of the Bible. Yeah, amen. The Southern Baptist just had 24 people run off in a conclave someplace, and they've come up with another new Bible. So we got another new one. A lot of them, and we're going to look at some of these things, but it's what they've left out and what they've done with God's Word. And so We look at the foundation of this nation crumbling. And I love you folks here, and I love what I'm hearing. And boy, I tell you, this is church. Don't know ye not, know ye not, you're the temple. This is church. And so I praise God for all of you. And looking forward to seeing what we can do with this thing. I have, this audio video people, this setup is just great. I didn't have to even get the stuff out of my van. I have three goals. To strengthen your faith in the Word of God. If you're not saved, I'm going to try to get you saved. That's what we're all about, folks. We're in a time you can't hide. I talk about New World Order. I talk about the technology. I talk about my involvement in the technology, but there's no place for you to hide. If you don't stand on the rock, Jesus Christ, there's no place for you to hide. If you're saved and you're not doing much for the Lord, I'm here to make you feel uncomfortable. I just want to tell you up front, that's what I'm doing, okay? I want to be honest with you. And then, the end has come upon the four corners of the land. Now is the end come upon thee, and I will send mine anger upon, and I will judge thee according to thy ways, and will recompense upon all thine abominations. This nation, the hedge of protection, has been taken down around it because the church has fallen asleep. The church is fast asleep, and Satan's rocking the cradle. And I'm going to tell you something. In and out of the churches, over and over again, we're seeing it. The church is a playground now. The bride has got her bra strap hanging out. She's got her dress messed up. She's got her hair messed up. Her face is messed up. The bride is not ready. And I'm going to tell you something. This thing is coming on us fast. For I testify unto every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book, if any man shall add unto these words, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. And if any man shall take away from the words of this book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life and out of the holy city from the things that are written in this book. It's amazing. School of Theology 101, two basic facts of human enlightenment. There is a God. And you're not him. Okay? Shirley MacLaine stood out there with her arms stretched up saying, I'm a God, I'm a God. No, Shirley, your underarm deodorant's failed and you're not a God. Praise God. So, is the Bible fact or fiction? Well, I'll tell you something. The Bible joins the list of banned books. 38 states have banned this old Bible from their libraries, from public libraries. So, and part of that's right in Virginia. Yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. Have you been persecuted? If you haven't been, you ought to check out your salvation because you got a problem. Praise God. All that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. But evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. This was a picture from an underground church in China, and she was sewing a Bible together by hand. I went into China in the early 80s, and it was amazing that we found around 55 million Christians in China when the bamboo curtain came down. When the missionaries left, when everything had been shut down, there was around 5 million Christians in China under the severest of persecution. The banning of the Bibles, the burning of the Bibles, the slaughtering of past church pastors. The church grew to 55 million. You need to think about that. You need to think about that. Why? You say, what? What are you doing with Decon up on the screen? That's kind of silly. Well, Decon, a lot of you use Decon to get rid of rats and mice and this type of thing. Politicians. Hey, by the way, did you ever think about politics? Poly is artificial polymer. It is plastic, okay? And a tick is a blood-sucking little varmint that gets on your dog. And you put the two together, you get poly ticks, and you send them to Washington, D.C., and they'll suck the blood out of the country. Yeah. Well, there's something you might not know about Decon. Decon is only 0.005% poison. It's 99.995% good food. It doesn't take very much of changing God's word, just a little bit, turns it from truth into poison. So, why should we worry about small, minor changes to the holy word of God? Well, scientists marvel at how children are conformed to the fixed physical likeness of their parents through several microns that hold the formulas several feet long. This is your DNA that we're talking about here. For the complex genetic code to create 60 trillion highly differentiated cells. A little nervous up here. You guys are special. And boy, we got some great speakers here, and so just had to put up with me. As with the genetic, if God put the key to you and I into the genetic code, and he did it so carefully that we're reproduced perfectly as we come, what do you think he's going to do with his word? I'm going to tell you something. Numerology, the looking at numbers, the looking at things that go on in the construction of the King James Bible. By the way, the King James Bible is the only translation we have. The rest of them are not translations. I'll prove it to you in a little bit. It's I think so. It's Pete. Amen. This is Frank Logsdon, who was the guy that came up with the New American Standard. He actually headed the team. He said, I must under God renounce everything. He renounced everything that he had done on the New American Standard Bible. He asked for God's forgiveness, and that's available to you. This thing is, all of this is available to you through our website and through our information. But this man renounced everything that he had done. He tried to tell people what they had done, and nobody would listen. It's amazing. Reasons for using only a King James. The Message, the authorized King James Bible, most fully presents the central doctrines of our Christian faith. Trinity, deity of Christ, salvation by faith, and all the rest of it. The English vocabulary used does not permit a variety of liberal interpretations. Hell versus Hades, fornication versus sexual immorality, him verse 1. The manuscripts, boy, I'll tell you, antiquity. All of the documents, the majority text, continuity, variety, both geographic and type of witness, number, the overwhelming majority of witnesses, the evidence, all of the documents that prove that old Bible is right, the method. The King James uses FE, or formal equivalency. In other words, when you're translating a word, they used the English words that describe that. It might have taken three words to describe one Greek word or one Hebrew word. But it was the direct equivalent. Now, the new versions use the DE, or the dynamic equivalency, and it's an interpretation, not a translation. So this is where the mistakes come from. It gives no opportunity for private interpretation by translators. You know, it's amazing. Memorization. King James is very easy to memorize. Fourth grader can memorize the King James. I had a little granddaughter that could read the King James fluently in the fourth grade. Amazing. For what purpose would you remove the following 17 scriptures? And we've got these all printed out and this type of thing. The scribes in the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, reasoned together to see how they could take Jesus and how they could kill him. That was the whole purpose behind their meetings and getting together to try to kill him. The modern day scribes have done the same thing with the Bible. And they're no better off than those scribes were. They remove Jesus Christ, they remove the deity, they remove a lot of things out of the Bible. And the chiefs, the scribes and the chief priests heard it and sought. I'm supposed to have a laser pointer here. Well, the pointer don't work. The scribes and the chief priests heard it and sought after how they might destroy him. For they feared him because of all the people. All the people were astonished at his doctrine. And so, how about this one? Howbeit, this kind goeth out not but by prayer and fasting. It's not in the NIV. It's not in New American Standard. It's not in the Bad News for Modern Man. It's not in the rest of it, okay? They eliminated it. How about 18:11? Matthew 18:11, for the Son of Man is come to save that which was lost. Matthew 23:14, woe unto you scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you desire widows' houses, and for a pretense make long prayer, therefore ye shall receive the greater damnation. Can you see why the writers of the NIV, non-informed version is what it's called, can you see why they wanted to eliminate these scriptures? They don't like it. They don't like it. How about, but if you don't forgive, neither will your Father, which is in heaven, forgive your trespasses. They did away with that one. None of these are in the Bible. I sometimes will stand up and I'll say, and I'll know that people have NIVs or they have New American Standards or they got, all this kind of stuff. And I'll hand out those scriptures, 17 of them, and I'll say, now I want you to look these up. And they can't find them in their Bibles. It makes an interesting, sometimes they don't ask you to come back and preach again. And the scripture was fulfilled which saith, and he was numbered with the transgressors. And Philip said, if thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. These are just a few of the scriptures that have been left out of the new perversions. So I'd throw that up there. Look at some of the changes. We call it the new Christianity, but look at them. NIV and NASB, keep on the alert. King James says watch and pray. How about Matthew 17:21 has been admitted. This kind goeth out not by prayer and fasting. How about the next one's omitted? And the next one. And this kind can come out only by prayer. This kind can come out only by prayer and fasting. Trying to do away with the fasting. A lot of people, a lot of Christians are biblical. Paul says to buffet our bodies. And did you know buffet and buffet are spelt the same? I just thought I'd throw that out. Man shall not live on bread alone. And look what they did to it. That man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word of God. You see what they cut out? So if you got an NIV or a New American Standard, if you roll it up real tight and put it in a fireplace, it burns quite a while. Long for the pure spiritual milk. I desire the sincere milk of the Word. Isn't that amazing? Gospels and Gods of the New Age. Look at them. Look what they've done. A gospel. The gospel. That if they come to you preaching another gospel, don't listen to them. Well, here we got a gospel. I'll just give you a few of them. Here we have men down below here, and then rich men. Angels, holy angels. There's some angels wandering around here, folks, that aren't holy angels. You know that? They're fallen angels. They're a mess. They'll get right in and right in with you. Some of them are sitting in the church. Down below, Spirit and Holy Ghost. I like the Holy Ghost. I like that Spirit thing. They got a song, Holy Spirit, Thou art welcome in this place. Beautiful song. But folks, if you didn't bring him with you, he's not here. He's not coming through the air conditioning ducts. You know, we got to watch out what we sing sometimes. Test one for the Antichrist. Who is a liar, but he denieth that Jesus Christ, Jesus is the Christ. He is Antichrist. Okay. Look at it. The new versions, Christ, our new conversions, Jesus. The King James says Christ Jesus. I can do everything through him that gives the strength. Oh, really? I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me. Quite a difference in the rendering. The gospel of Christ. Lord Jesus Christ. You see what they did? They chop off. See, one's a name and the other's a title. And they want to get rid of the title. And so just a few things. Got so much. How about the second test for the Antichrist? Do you believe on the Son of Man? That's the new version. Dost thou believe on the Son of God? How about that? Then they admitted the next one. Just some little tests. You can go to 1 John and you can find out who the Antichrist is, who he denies Christ in the flesh. He who denies him. An heir through God. An heir of God through Christ. God who created all things. God who created all things by Jesus Christ. Okay? Grace to be to you and peace from God our Father. Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. So what they cut out may not be important to anybody else, but sure important to me. For many deceivers are entered into the world who confess not that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. This is a deceiver and an antichrist. You want to know who the antichrist is? There it is. But look what they did to it. Every spirit that does not acknowledge Jesus is not from God. But King James, every spirit that confesses not that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is not of God. You see the difference in the two of those, folks? It's amazing. The ascended Christ or the Antichrist? Boy, look at it. I have a lot of these, but boy, I tell you, what they did in the new versions, just cutting whole chunks out. Antichrist, King of Nations. Look at it. Look what they did in the new versions. King of Nations. What is he? King of Saints. Amen? And the nations shall walk by its light. What's an it? Bill Clinton. Bill Clinton wanted the definition of it. You know? Hey, you better believe it. And the nations of them which are saved, think about that, shall walk in the light of it. How about preaching the kingdom? Preaching the kingdom of God. His kingdom, kingdom of God. His kingdom, the kingdom of God. You see what they did with the kingdom of God? Yeah. He shall wipe away, God shall wipe away all tears. How about the he? I've come to do thy will. I've come to do thy will, O God. He who is revealed. Well, let's move on. The New King James is really wild. Now, in order to, one thing about the King James, it's not copyrighted. You can set up a printing press in your backyard, and you can print as many King James Bibles as you want. There's never been a copyright on the King James. But in order for them to sell these Bibles and to have a copyright, they had to modify and change the wording enough. So let's look at that first one there, sir, instead of Lord. I called my dad sir, and because he had a razor strap that would straighten me out if I got out of line. And I yes-sired him all the time he was alive. Before him saying master, and worship him saying Lord, there's a lot of difference. Anyway, kneeling down, worshiping him. The changes that they made, teacher, master. A lot of difference between a teacher and a master. Good teacher, good master. Teacher and master once again. So these are just some of the changes. The beast and the blood. One of the things they did was do away with the blood. They wanted to do, in whom we have redemption. Oh, really? In whom we have redemption through his blood. Again, completely eliminating the blood. Faith, or through faith in the blood. Amazing. This is my body, which is for you. Well, isn't that neat? This is my body, which is broken for you. These are just changes, folks, over and over again. Progressive ages, the new age, the one world government is going to come about because of the political side, the religious side, the economics that is involved, those legs of the milk stool. And so we're looking at the new Bibles bringing us into that new age philosophy. Self-esteem. We had some guests up here speaking earlier. Boy, I loved it. But it's a lot of things. Religious tolerance. One world religion. Look at some of the entries down there. Just amazing. Let's go to the next one. The one versus the holy one. Here's a good one. Rejects the one, despiseth him. The one, him. The one, he. The one who endures, he. One, he. All down the line. The one versus the holy one. How about this? Yeah. Look at this. The NIV. Instead of the head of the corner, the NIV uses capstone. In every case where he is the chief cornerstone, the Bible talks about it, the King James talks about it, they translate that capstone. The capstone on the, with the all-seeing eye of Osiris, it's on the back of your dollar bill. Get rid of them things. You can put them on my table over there. They got, you know, praise God. Annut Scieptis Novus Ordo Seclorum, Latin for announcing the birth of the New World Order. It's amazing. Another gospel. Look at this. Disobedience, unbelief. King James says unbelief. One of the sins that will flat put you into, you need asbestos underwear if you stand around in unbelief. Disobedience, believe not. Disobedience, disobedience. You know, you can have a kid that's disobedient, but boy, I tell you, it's important that you don't have unbelief in your life. Who believes? Isn't that amazing? Salvation by works or faith in Jesus Christ. Let's look at what they did. Folks, there's nothing you can do to to work your way to heaven. You are not good enough, and you will never be good enough, and you can never do enough to work your way to heaven. Yet look at what they've done in the new versions. Children, how hard is it to enter into the kingdom of God? On the surface, that doesn't look like too much of a change. Children, how hard it is for them that trust in riches to enter into the kingdom of God. By standing firm, you will save yourself. Folks, you can stand firm until rigor mortis sets in. You're not going to save yourself. It's not going to work. In your patience, possess ye your souls. Obey. And then we come to the word believeth. Folks, I want to tell you something. The word believeth and the word believe. The TH on the end of believe is an ongoing, continuous believing. The Spanish have a word they call, it says proveer. We have a word called provision. We can go back here and buy all the food, all the dehydrated food, and I'm sure that they would really like to have you do that, to freeze-dried food. Buy it all up and store it. But when it runs out, you don't have anything. But if you have proveer, you have an ongoing, continuous supply of that food the rest of your life. The word believeth means a continual believing, going on and on and on with a continual belief. The TH is very important on the end, a word of, on the end of the word believe. And so, but if he be of works, then it's no more grace. And look what they did. They omitted that verse completely. The gospel of Christ. Well, here's another one. I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. They omitted that. In whom we have redemption. In whom we have redemption through his blood. He who believes has everlasting life. He that believeth on me hath everlasting life. Teaching, doctrine. There's a lot of difference between teaching and doctrine, folks. The doctrine of the devil is being taught in a lot of places. Every spirit that does not acknowledge Jesus Christ, Jesus, is not from God. Every spirit that confesses not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is not of God. The word confesses is a covenant. When you confess, you make a covenant. When you confess him, you make a covenant with him. He will not break that covenant. You can break it, but he can't, and he won't. Very important words that they just leave out, acknowledge or confess. People say, you're out of your mind. No, I'm out of your mind. I'm in my mind. I know what's going on with me. Praise God. The word believeth and believe in the King James have the same Greek reference. 4100. However, the word believe in the American English means something quite different. Webster's Dictionary. To accept as real or true, to credit with verity, to think or suppose, there's the think or suppose, to hold religious beliefs. The new versions have lost the meaning of the original word by using dynamic equivalency, interpretation of translation. The King James uses the F.E., and I talked about that a little earlier, direct translation. Only the King James is a translation. The rest of the new versions are just interpretations. I think so. This is the word for believeth. I'm not going to go all the way through it, but folks, it is of the thing believe, to credit, have confidence in a moral or religious reference used in the New Testament of the conviction and trust into which a man is impelled by a certain inner and higher prerogative and law of soul. So it just gives you a little bit of that, what they translated, believeth. Did God confound or confuse? Some interesting things. I'm just trying to touch on a few of these things. King James says, therefore, is the name of it called Babel, because the Lord did there confound the language. There's a ripple in the screen over there. Confound the language of the earth, and from thence did the Lord scatter them abroad upon the face of the earth. Now, the NIV says this is why it is called Babel, because that the Lord confused the language of the whole world. And you may not think that means much, but and then the Lord scattered them over the face of the whole earth. But 1 Corinthians 14:33 says, "For God is not the author of confusion, but of peace, as in all the churches of the saints." If you change the word from confounded, which is a shifting of the syllables, and you change it to confuse, you have made God a liar. Because God has said, "I'm not the author of confusion." There's a lot of difference between the word confounded and the word confused. So I just thought I'd throw that out to you. Hell is omitted 50% of the time in the New Testament. Hell is omitted 100% of the times in the Old Testament. Isn't that amazing? New versions omit the three main characters of the Old Testament, Jehovah and Lucifer. Heaven is also greatly reduced. Look at it. Father, Father which is in heaven. Father, you could have a priest being a father. Do you ever think about, you know, a lot of people, and I'm not hitting the Catholics now, but they trust their prayers to Mary. You know that? Yeah. But did you know that Mary lost Jesus for 3 days and couldn't find him? Do you want to trust your prayers to somebody that lost Jesus for 3 days? They had to turn around and bring the caravan back and found him reasoning with the priest. It's amazing. Everybody says, and I'm in Catholic magazines, I'm in Nexius, and they write articles about me, a lot of good things. How about this one? The New American Standard. Boy, kind of interesting, isn't it? Just a little bit of change. Immorality instead of fornication. See, immorality is just a state of mind. It's an act. But fornication is a physical act of having intercourse. That's fornication. There's a lot of difference between those two words, folks. Talk about dumbing this thing down. They really did. How about this? Okay. I'm getting the high sign over here. They got a hook that comes out and gets your leg in a little bit. In the last days, men shall be heady, high-minded. And so we look at the word they used for new. New in the King James, in the New American Standard, they made it unshrunk. Now, you talk about a kid reading this and saying, "What's unshrunk?" But look at several of them there. Winnowing fork, the King James says fan. These new Bibles aren't easier to read. They're harder to read. What's a kid going to do with a winnowing fork? But a fan, he would understand. You know, that's just some amazing things. Okay. Plantable biochip, mark of the beast, in the right hand or the forehead. Here's what brought me to my knees, folks. Will you take it serious? Revelation 13, 16 through 8. Now the reason I'm putting this up here is this is what brought me to the King James Bible. Okay? I had New American Standard. I was wandering along, just thought I was doing good. But it was this that brought me to the King James Bible. The new Bibles use in or on instead of in. The ASV uses on the right hand or upon the forehead. And so that's kind of amazing. The word stigma is where it was at. The three words for Mark are chirogma, charagator, and charax. These words, 5480, 81, and 82, chirogma, a scratch and etching, charagator, an engraving, an exact copy, an express image, charax, just amazing. I got to move along. The word chixastigma is the word for 666. 22nd, 14th, an obsolete letter of the Greek alphabet, intermediate between the 5th and 6th. He uses numbers denoting respectively 600, 3, score, and 6. The problem was the 4742 is a cross. This is right out of Strong's Concordance. You go down to 4742, it says stigma, stizo, to stick, to prick, a mark, incised, or punched for recognition of ownership. So we're talking about something under the skin. And I wanted to just pass that on to you. This is what brought me to my knees. I've been asked if 666 is involved in the architecture of the implantable biochip. Well, it's an 18-bit word. A computer that I was working on at that time, a Dynet 30, a communications processor, used an 18-bit word, 3 6-bit characters. I'd be thrilled to answer any questions or offer any help I can. Please don't hesitate to call me if you need assistance. Like Paul on Mars Hill in Acts 17, we need to use this information for evangelism, and we'll get the same three results Paul got. Some believed, some mocked, and some said we'll think about it. We found this to be an exciting and fruitful ministry for the kingdom of God. We welcome others to join in and feel free to use anything we have. That's my address, and that's a little different than the one on the literature, and that one works also. But I want to finish very quickly with something. People ask me why I'm out here doing this. My kids say, Dad, why don't you just sit on the porch and take it easy? You're 73 years old. You've done all these things. But you know what? There are people that haven't heard, and there are people that need the message. So I preach on New World Order, Signs of Nature Society, and all those kind of things. I was preaching after I came out of the hospital, and a man came to me, and he said, I want to talk to you a minute. He said, he was an ex-quarterback for the Dallas Cowboys many years ago. And he said, there was a young man who used to come to the field, stand around the field, and he said, watch the practices. And he said, I taught him how to run pass patterns. I taught him some things. But I never told him about Jesus. He said the young man went on to become the leading pass receiver in the nation, went on to be drafted by the Detroit Lions. And he said, one day I'm going to tell him about Jesus. He said he never got around to it. Detroit was playing Chicago Bears in Chicago. The young man was having a great game, his rookie year. Went up, caught a pass, pulled it down, fell hard on the frozen turf. They came out. He made it back to the huddle. The next play, he went out along the line of scrimmage, turned up the field. Did a little button hook and fell on the field. They carried him off the field. About 15 minutes later, the announcement came on national television that the young man had died on the field. The old quarterback said, I never got to tell him about Jesus. And he said, he gave me a poem. And he said, wherever you're at least one time, give this poem. And it's a poem as if it's called My Friend, and as if that young man was standing on the other side in the white throne judgment. And he was looking over. And he said, my friend, I stand in judgment now, and I feel that you're to blame somehow. On earth I walked with you day by day, and never did you point the way. You knew the Lord in truth and glory, but never did you share the story. My knowledge then was very dim. You could have led me safe to him. Oh, we walked by day and talked by night, and yet you showed me not to light. You let me live and love and die. You knew I'd never live on high. Yes, I called you friend in life and trusted you through joy and strife. And yet on coming to this end, I cannot now call you my friend. I pray that I've been your friend. Look around you at the people you pass by every day. Folks, this thing is winding down. It's coming down fast. But I'm going to tell you, there's one blessed hope, and that's this word. Amen. And standing on the rock, Jesus Christ, and sharing your testimony with others. And I praise God for you. I thank you for allowing me to come. Butch, I love you, brother, and it's been special to be here with all of you people. Thank you.
Thank you.
God bless you. Okay, let me get you up to